Well, it's also important to note that the number of men that are not getting married is increasing as well. And in fact, I'm coming across a lot of men, teenagers as well as brothers above the age of 25 who are deciding to not marry because they have seen the stories, and women as well, men and women have heard the stories of brothers and sisters and cousins and uncles, and they have seen firsthand parent relationships that ultimately proved to be unsuccessful and unsatisfying. So a lot of black people, being afraid of black people, are choosing not to get married because of the fear of harm being done. Here's what it comes down to on the relationship level. Well, first let's look at it politically and then just look at it psycho-spiritually. On the political end, it's difficult for black men and black women to get along, number one, because we have been socialized by the European, okay, to consider each other and ourselves as worth less. So a black man, many have difficulty respecting black women because he sees her through sky blue eyes. In other words, the black man sees the black woman the same way as the white man sees, as a bitch and a sexual prostitute. Hence how she's often referred to in the so-called hip-hop community. Okay? The average rapper refers to a black woman as a bitch. Okay? The average brother refers to a black woman as a bitch, whether he says it verbally or whether he simply says it in his mind. So we have to understand that the psyche that we're using to engage our women with is a falsified consciousness that was implanted in us by our enslavers. So the black man is dealing with the white woman, the black man is dealing with the black woman the same way the white man would deal with the black woman in slavery. She's only good for one thing, sex, and to reproduce. Other than that, get the hell out of my face. Ironically enough, Brother Gus, the black woman is doing the exact same thing. She has been trained by her enslaver, and the behavior has been passed down from generation until generation. And by the way, we are only 5 generations out of slavery. So I want to be crystal clear about that. My great-great-great-grandfather, George Washington Bailey, the nephew of Frederick Douglass, was an enslaved African. So we're only 4 or 5 generations out. So when we talk about passing down, okay, pathological behavior that was taught, okay, we're not talking about it being necessarily passed down 10 generations. That's the case, too. But for those of us who are walking this earth now in African skin, okay, that's only 4 or 5 generations ago, depending on your age. So the black woman was also taught to see the black man as nothing. In slavery, the black man was only good for 2 things. Sex, for the white woman and for the homosexual white slave master. And to do what? Reproduce babies. They called him a buck. In fact, one of the most popular rappers in the game, he's called Young Buck. And when a black woman sees a man, what is the first thing she's looking at him for? Economic potential. When a slave master saw a black man, what was the first thing he was looking for? Economic potential. When a slave master saw a black woman, what's the first thing he was looking for? Sexual fulfillment and baby-making capabilities. When a black man sees a black woman, what's the first thing he's looking for? Sexual fulfillment only. He ain't even concerned about the baby-making capability. So when you look at the primary reasons or the primary factors upon which we evaluate each other, the black woman evaluates the black man for his economic potential that is identical to slavery, and the black man evaluates the black woman for her sexual potential identical to slavery. So you have to look at the role of post-traumatic slavery disorder in the way in which we interact with each other. Slavery reversed the natural order of things in the black home and in the black community. In most cultures globally, the male is considered the protector and the provider. In most cultures globally, slavery began to change that. The woman, okay, was always considered to be feminine, and she was considered to be a domestic. She would stay in the home, and she would regulate the internal order of the family. That was the role of the woman. But slavery reversed that. And American society today, the European social order, is continuing to reverse that. Beginning with slavery and finally being completed today, right now, before our faces, the black woman has been transformed from a female into a she-male. From a female into a she-male. A she-male is a woman or a human being that looks like a woman, has the breasts, the buttocks, the hips, the beauty, the glamour, the glitz of a woman. But psychologically, she thinks like a European alpha male. And that is what the white man has done to the black woman psychologically. He has transformed her into a European alpha male that is encapsed in a black female's body. So now the black woman is the protector and the provider. She's no longer the great feminine force that she was inside the home. She's traded in that for a life outside of the home, okay, where she is the primary protector and provider of the family and of her children. Now, some sisters are going to say, well, Dr. Umar, what's wrong with that? If the man is not there, are we not naturally supposed to become the protector and the provider? Yes. But you also have to understand how in the natural order of things, our ancestors designed our culture and our God designed our culture so that the masculine and the feminine principle would coexist side by side in equal balance, in equal balance, in equal balance. But when the black man is taken from the home, the balance is disturbed. And now the black woman has to try to be both a female and a male at the same time, engage in traditional feminine tasks, but now take on the more masculine responsibilities of protecting and providing. And when you've done that for 10 centuries, excuse me, when you've done that for 10 generations, or when you've done that for 12 or 13 generations, then you get so used to it that you don't want to go back to the way things are supposed to be. Which means that when some sisters find a strong black man, a good brother, it's kind of hard for them to give back some of the control. It's kind of hard for them to give back some of the responsibility for providing. It's kind of hard to give back some of the responsibility for protecting because although it's difficult taking care of that house by yourself, although it's burdensome raising those black boys by yourself, you have grown to not have to be accountable to nobody but yourself. And so what we have is a situation now that when black women find good men, I'm not talking about deadbeats. I'm not talking about pimps. I'm talking about good black men. Sometimes they run those brothers away because the brother is a man and wants to be respected as a man, but some sisters aren't willing to give back some of the power so they can share in equal balance. In order for that black man to coexist with her, because she's now become the male, he has to become the female. And what do we have in the black community all across America, Canada, London, and in the Caribbean? Women taking care of men. The roles have totally reversed, Brother Gus, in many cases, where the man stays home and the woman goes out and works and pays the rent. She pays the bills, and he sits home and do nothing, some of them not even taking care of the children. But on the flip side, you have the same situation where a black man meets a strong, good black woman, but because he has developed this negative perception of what black women are as only being good for sex, he never even considers the fact that this woman may have been sent by the ancestor to be his life mate. And rather than raise her up as the queen she is, rather than raise her up as the divine impersonalization of the great supreme energy, he simply mistreats her, uses her for sex, or so forth and so on. The point that I'm trying to make is the reason our relationships are failing, and the reason you see an increase in the amount of black women who choose not to get married but could, and an increase in the amount of black men who are choosing not to get married but could, is because, number one, we have been conditioned to work against each other's natural position in the home. Conditioned to work against it. Number two, because we've been taught to hate anything black, including our partner. And number three, we do not want to share power in the household. We are like little European dictators in the home. You want to live with me? Well, you better get used to my rules, says the black man. He oppresses his black woman. And guess what she does? The same damn thing. You want to live with me? I make more money than you. You want to live with me? I have a doctorate. All you have is an associate's degree. So because the European gave me more paperwork than you got, because I got more credentials from the cracker, I'm going to run the house. And you can either like it or get out. The bottom line, Brother Gus, is we do not want to share power with each other in the homes, because we've been taught by our slave masters that our partner, our male or our female, is less than us. So who are they to be telling us what to do? Furthermore, who are they to even be sharing power with me? You can't beat the white man outside until you destroy the one living inside. Black people always talking about the white man, but what about the one living in you? If you don't deal with the demon inside you that is controlling your thought, your behavior, and your feelings, whether you beat the one outside or not, it's irrelevant, because he has already incarnated in your person.